Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Little Rock Board of Directors meeting for May 3rd, 2016. I'd like to welcome everybody that's with us here in City Hall this evening. Thank you for being here. We've got a fairly long agenda, but hopefully we can move through it quickly. But first, we need to read the roll. Madam Clerk, if you would, please.
Director Hendricks, Director Richardson, Director Webb, Director Cazort, Director Wright, Director Wyrick, Director Campuris, Director Fortson, Director Adcock, Vice Mayor Hines, Mayor Stodler.
Here. Let me call on Vice Mayor Lance Hines for our invocation, please.
Thank you. I'll bow your heads, please. Dear Lord, thank you for letting us be here today to do the people's business as we go forward as a city. Please watch all over our police and fire and our public works and parks employees as they do the day-to-day work for the city and our folks. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you would, please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we get into the agenda, we have some presentations to make. Let me call on our city manager, Bruce Moore, for an employee retirement recognition.
Mayor, members of the board, tonight we have one part of a dynamic duo that has served the city for quite some time. Tonight we have Detective Linda Hudson, who's retiring from the Little Rock Police Department. Detective Hudson has 28 years of service, very unique in one sense, 23 years with the Little Rock Police Department and 5 years with Human Resources. Her awards and honors include Officer of the Month while in patrol, a unit condemnation while in with robbery and financial crimes unit. And her favorite memory of working for the city is all of the friends that I've made throughout the years who just started off as co-workers. Linda's plans for retirement include eventually traveling to the beach and relaxing. At this time, let me ask Chief Kenton Buckner to come forward. Chief.
Mayor, Vice Mayor Hines, members. Linda is, you know, I've only been here a couple of years, but Linda has a great reputation for the work that she does as a detective. She's been very instrumental in putting a lot of very bad people in our city away. Her little docile kind of appearance, and she looks kind of like a librarian, but she's very, very tenacious about how she goes about catching criminals. To Mr. Moore's point earlier, but most of my value for her comes from that, you know, she's Tommy's wife, and a police chief tries to stay on good footing with the FOP president. So she puts a smile on his face, which keeps him off of my back, and we greatly appreciate her, and we're going to miss her. But I am a little concerned with all of this free time that she's going to have that we're going to see some more grievances or something. Okay.
Detective Hudson, if you please join me. Tommy, why don't you come on up to you?
Yeah.
The other part of the dynamic duo. Would let Jennifer take a great picture. But on behalf of the City of Little Rock, thank you for 28 years of dedicated service to the department, to the citizens, and to this organization. Thank Congratulations.
You. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Congratulations for putting up with Tommy.
I know. Thank you. Thank you.
Please.
Oh, I'm good. I'm not good with words, but I really appreciate it. I have enjoyed my time at the city, and I really appreciate being able to work here and being able to get to know everybody, and I wish everybody well. Thank you, guys.
Best of luck, Linda, and make sure Tommy stays in line. I have a couple other announcements. I have issued a proclamation to recognize the fact that this is International Building Safety Month, and it's certainly important that we recognize all of the various licensed individuals that help us make sure that these buildings are safe. And I want you to know that this month is the month of May proclaimed to be International Building Safety Month. The next presentation we have is our 2016 Comcast Leaders and Achievers Scholarship recipients. Mr. Moore?
Mayor, let me call on Ms. Evangeline Parker to make the next presentation. Evangeline.
To the mayor, city board, Bruce Moore, city manager, I am truly honored to be here with you this evening to present the 2016 Comcast Leaders and Achievers Scholarship recipients. Thank you all so much for making time in the agenda for this. I always like to make sure that our young people are surrounded by true leaders, and that's why I always ask if we can come so they can see true leadership in action by watching you all. And this evening, we are celebrating the 15th anniversary of the Comcast Leaders and Achievers Scholarship Awards Program. And to date, the Comcast Foundation, which is a sponsor of these awards, it has awarded $24 million in scholarships to nearly 23,000 students nationwide. Here in Arkansas to date, we've awarded over $106,000 to 106 Arkansas high school seniors, selected Comcast Leaders and Achievers Scholarship recipients. Students are nominated by their high school principal or counselor. They're recognized with a one-time scholarship in the amount of $1,000 for the pursuit of higher education. And I do want to acknowledge the parents who are here. We have counselors, school counselors, and principals here. Will you all stand, please, so we can see you and recognize you? Thank you. Thank you all so much. Thank you. Because without them, we would not have a Comcast Leaders and Achievers Scholarship Program. Comcast Leaders and Achievers exemplify what it means to be a citizen for change, a leader, a role model for other youth to follow. They have excelled in the areas of academics, community service, and leadership. And so tonight we do want to spotlight them and honor them. We have 10 Comcast Leaders and Achievers who have been selected. Five are here with us tonight, and I'm going to ask them to step forward and be recognized. First, we have Pearl Stephanie Arrieta. Pearl is a senior at Parkview Art Science Magnet High School. She is going to be attending the University of Arkansas at Little Rock this fall, majoring in computer engineering. Yes, I heard somebody say, yes, very smart. Next, we have Briley Palmer. She's a student at Little Rock Central High School. This fall, she will be attending the University of Arkansas at Fayetteville, majoring in fine arts and fashion. Next, we have Kyra Rattler. She is a student at McClellan High School. This fall, she will be attending the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, majoring in psychology. Next, we have Deja Taylor, a student at J.A. Fair High School. This fall, she will be attending Hendrix, majoring in chemical engineering. And next, we have Madison Winter, a student at North Little Rock High School West Campus. This fall, she will be attending the University of Arkansas, Fayetteville, majoring in chemistry and biology. So these are some very smart young people. If you all will help me salute them. Mayor.
Well, thank you, Evangeline, and congratulations to all these young ladies. It's certainly great to see the kind of achievements that they have already accomplished, and on behalf of the board, we wish them great success, academic success in particular, as they move on into college. Do we have any parents here with them, by chance? If we do, if you'd stand up and be recognized. I saw a couple people taking pictures, yeah. All right. Very good. Thank you for being with us. Thank you, Evangeline. They're majoring in things that I had a hard time even struggling through in high school. I'm very impressed. Okay, we can now move on to our consent agenda. We've got six, well, first of all, we have a modification page. Board members, if you would, there's a recommended addition of M1, an ordinance to clarify an inaccurate legal description, and then a deferral of item number 20, number 34 for 2 weeks.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Those will be added and deferred. And Director Adcock, did you have a question? Okay, thank you. We can now move on to the consent agenda, items 1 through 16. Madam Clerk, if you would read the consent agenda items, please.
The consent agenda consists of a motion to approve the minutes of the December 1st, 2015, December 15th, 2015 Little Rock City Board of Directors meetings, and the December 8th, 2015 Little Rock City Board of Directors reconvene meeting. A resolution to set May 17th, 2016 as the date of hearing on the petition to appeal the Planning Commission's action approving a conditional use permit to allow the Chenal Lofts high-rise multifamily development proposed for the O2 Office and Institutional District zone property located at 15,401 Chenal Parkway in the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, a resolution authorized the city manager to enter into a contract with Action Target for the total amount of $170,912, including tax, for the purchase of firing range equipment to support the Little Rock Police Department modern rifle and pistol training activities, and for the purposes, funding from the 2012 3/8 cent capital improvement sales tax. A resolution to approve an open data policy for the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to authorize the city manager to enter into a contract with AMR Construction LLC General Contractors to construct the Big Dam Bridge restroom in amount of $218,546 plus a 5% contingency for a total amount of $230,048, and for the purposes, a resolution authorizes the city manager to apply for and utilize federal aid recreation trail funds for the Recreational Trails Program and Transportation Alternatives Program grants at the Little Rock Zoo, and for the purposes, a resolution to express the willingness of the City of Little Rock, Arkansas, to utilize federal aid Transportation Alternative Program funds for the construction of the Roosevelt Road sidewalk project, and for the purposes, a resolution authorizes the city manager to enter into a general contract with Shields and Associates Incorporated in the amount of $67,000 for the purchase and installation of new windows in the River Market Building, and for the purposes, a resolution to authorize the city manager to award a contract to Gene Summers Construction Incorporated in an amount not to exceed $647,129.90 for improvements to Potter Street from Colonel Glenn Road to 40th Street, and for the purposes, funding for the 2012 3/8 cent capital sales tax and the 2013 limited tax general obligation capital improvement bonds. A resolution authorized the city manager to award a contract to Gene Summers Construction Incorporated in an amount not to exceed $648,000 for improvements to 44th Street from Boyd Street to Potter Street, and for the purposes, funding from the 2012 3/8 cent capital sales improvement sales tax and the 2013 limited tax general obligation capital improvement bonds. A resolution authorized the city manager to award a contract to Redstone Construction Group Incorporated in amount not to exceed $265,642.80 for improvements to W Street from Grant Street to University Avenue, and for other purposes, funding from the 2012 3/8 cent capital improvement sales tax and the 2013 limited tax general obligation capital improvement bonds. A resolution authorized the city manager to award a contract to Burkhalter Technologies Incorporated in amount not to exceed $138,567 for White Willow Court drainage, and for other purposes, funding from the 2012 3/8 cent capital improvement sales tax and the 2013 limited tax general obligation capital improvement bonds. A resolution authorized the execution of a 5-year extension of the interlocal agreement between the City of Little Rock, Arkansas and the City of North Little Rock, Arkansas to allow Metropolitan Emergency Medical Services to continue to provide emergency medical services and non-emergency routine transports in North Little Rock pursuant to an exclusive franchise, and for other purposes, a resolution authorized the execution of a 5-year extension of the interlocal agreement between the City of Little Rock, Arkansas and the City of Sherwood, Arkansas to allow Metropolitan Emergency Medical Services to continue to provide emergency medical services and non-emergency routine transports Transports in Sherwood pursuant to an exclusive franchise, and for other purposes, a resolution to authorize the execution of a 5-year extension of the interlocal agreement between the City of Little Rock, Arkansas and Pulaski County, Arkansas to allow Metropolitan Emergency Medical Services to continue to provide emergency medical services and non-emergency routine transports to Pulaski County, Arkansas pursuant to an exclusive franchise, and for the purposes, a resolution to amend Little Rock, Arkansas Ordinance Number 14,312 of April the 5th, 2016 to correct the name of the leasing entity for the leasing of golf carts, utility vehicles, a ball picker utility car, and a concession refreshment utility car for the Rebsamen, Heineman, and War Memorial golf courses, and for the purposes. That concludes the consent agenda.
Move for the adoption of the consent agenda.
Second. There's a motion and a second. Director Hendricks, did you have a question on any of these items? Yes. Number 7. What is your question?
It's not a question. It's a comment. Well, I'm probably to have a question. Mr. Moore, do you know whether this would be both sides of Roosevelt Road?
The north side, Director Hendricks.
Is there any consideration for the south side?
We don't have the funding for that. This is just funding for the north side.
Okay. My comment is that I just want to say that and echo concerns of two of my constituents that's present tonight, is that we look forward in the future to such activities being afforded for sidewalks or any other subjects that the citizens are concerned about. Okay, that's my comment. And the reason why I say that to the audience is that several, I would say about 2 years ago, maybe more than 2 years ago, this had come up and nothing was said about it. As a minority, I get so disgusted when certain people come and everything happens. It just flips. And I think all of you all know I will speak that. And I wanted to go on record. It bothers me. Thank you.
Director Richardson, you're recognized, please.
Yes, Mayor. Just a point of clarification for Director Hendricks. I think it came up about 4 years ago. We had two young 15-year-olds. I think they got run over on Roosevelt between Izzard and Chester. And I think the request was made about 4 years ago for funding for sidewalks in that area, both north and south. And I'm not sure at the time whether or not, if my memory serves me correctly, whether or not funding was the issue or jurisdiction was the issue, or whether or not it was told to the group who made a request that this state highway and it wasn't city business. So just a point of clarification on that, Bruce. Just shed a little light on what Director Hendricks was talking about. And you may want to give us more clarification on that.
Mr. Moore, did you want to comment?
I think it's fairly accurate. When this came up a few years ago, Director Hendricks felt very strongly that this was a state highway and responsibility of the highway department. We did actually visit with the representatives at that time, and they worked, I think, very hard to try to identify funding.
Good.
And again, the majority of this funding is state.
Thanks, Bruce.
Director Hendricks, yes.
I just want to clarify, it's not that I wanted it was a state law. And the only reason why it's a sidewalk in front of my house is because whoever built that house put a sidewalk there. And Ms. Director Richardson, the two young men that died in front of my house.
I remember.
Yes.
Okay, we've had a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda and discussion. All in favor of the passage of the resolutions indicate by saying aye. Opposed, say nay. Okay. Everybody voted yes? Okay. Okay, excuse me. We come to a portion in our meeting now called Citizen Communication, which is an opportunity for members of the public to express an issue, either written or oral, a grievance, or any other kind of message they wish on some specific item that has not already been on one of our agendas. So with that said, I've got a couple of people here who would like to talk to us about B-City USA. Peter Southmont. Peter, if you come forward, please.
That's not what it is. Honorable Mayor Stodola, Vice Mayor Hines, City Directors, and City Manager, my name is Peter Stuckey. I am a city citizen and a beekeeper. I am also the president of the Central Arkansas Beekeepers Association. And as the president of the Central Arkansas Beekeepers Association, I want to encourage the city of Little Rock to consider being designated a Bee City USA. Bee City USA fosters ongoing dialogue in urban areas to raise awareness of the role pollinators play in sustaining 3/4 of the world's plant species and what each of us can do to provide them with healthy habitat. Pollinators include the honeybee, native bees, bumblebees, butterflies, and other insects that collect pollen or redistribute pollen as they obtain nectar from flowering plants. In 2006, when honeybee colonies started disappearing, later dubbed colony collapse disorder, beekeepers and non-beekeepers alike became very concerned. After all, one out of every 3 bites of the food that we eat is courtesy of insect pollinators. CCD, or colony collapse disorder, has been determined to be caused by a number of factors, including pesticides, lack of habitat due to human expansion, and other pressures by diseases and parasites. The city of Little Rock has already started on the path of protecting pollinators by designating that all new construction take green spaces into consideration, as well as the protection of our waterways and city parks. In addition, the use of bee-friendly plants in city flower gardens and plots also shows the city's commitment to pollinators. Having Little Rock become part of the Bee City USA movement would further Little Rock's commitment to support pollinators. To become designated a Bee City USA, Little Rock would need to express support of pollinators via a resolution and proclamation and provide these along with an application to the Bee City USA organization. Once certified, the city would need to support pollination via a proclamation, via a proclamation and other public awareness activities. The city would further acknowledge its commitment through signage and web links, helping everyone learn about pollinators. Annually, a report would need to be provided to the Bee City USA organization to report the city's activities in support of pollinators, along with a renewal form. By designating Little Rock as a Bee City USA, the city of Little Rock will be taking a bold step in supporting pollinators like honeybees. Thank you. May I answer any questions?
Is there any questions for Mr. Stuckey? Mr. Stuckey, I apologize for calling you Southmont, but that you put your street address.
Did I do that
wrong?
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Are there any questions for Mr. Stuckey? Oh, go ahead, Director Adcock. Excuse me.
About a month ago, Mr. Stuckey came and we had a talk about this, and I took the information to Mr. Jones. So Mr. Jones has been looking at this, and I'd ask Peter to come tonight so the board would be aware of what we're looking at with this. And
okay.
James Jones.
Well, thank you, Mr. Stuckey, and we'll ask our staff to give us to take this under consideration and get back with us about your request.
Thank you.
For us to become. It's surprising how many people are into this as an avocation. I continually run into people who are in the business, and it reminds me back when my grandfather was a beekeeper, and the first thing I
it's actually
really
something
aware
we've really seen a loss of since World War II. When beekeeping became industrialized, the family beekeepers went away. It used to be that nearly every family had a hive or two on their property. Mm-hmm. And that is now, with the advent of CCD, or colony collapse disorder, more people are becoming interested in having one or two hives on their property and taking it up as a hobby.
Mr. Ferguson, did you also want to, this is the same issue, did you want to add any comment to Mr. Stuckey's?
Thank you, Mayor Stodola, Mr. Moore, Manager Moore, ladies and gentlemen of the council. My name is Brent Ferguson, and I'd like to thank the council for supporting the, wish to ask you to thoroughly please consider approving and going after this honor or designation. You have shown with you're working with Dunbar Gardens. They have 5 beehives there, the last I saw. We have a beehive out in Western Hills Park. Unfortunately, there was some vandalism there a little over a month ago, and we had that cold snap about the same time. We lost a hive. I'm working with a couple other beekeepers to get a hive back out there for to keep it going for, you know, that way we can help our other people with hunger relief, I believe it is, down here by the train station. They've got three fields out there, and with the city's help, we've managed to put in a couple of beehives there to increase the crop. Are there any questions that you may have that I could possibly answer?
Director Richardson?
Thanks, Mayor. This is for Mrs. Ferguson, either you or Mrs. Stuckey. Are you guys specifically requesting a proclamation be issued by the city? I know you gave us a draft of one, and are we talking about using this as a model or framework for the city to develop a proclamation and issue one similar to this or this one exactly?
What we're asking for is for the city to consider becoming a Bee City USA. There is a process which is on, the fourth page.
There's an application.
The back of the second page tells you the steps to go through. Part of it is that you would issue a resolution and a proclamation, yes.
And Mayor or City Attorney, does that require any formal action by the board, or can this be something that's done administratively? Is it something Mr. Moore can do, or does that Mayor require formal action by this board?
Director Richardson, I've not had a chance to review the requirements of Bee City USA, but it does sound like in order to be a part of their organization that it does require a resolution. So without reading it thoroughly, from what they've presented, it sounds like it does require board action.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Yes, sir, Mr. Ferguson, you had another statement?
Yes, sir. One other thing I forgot. We do have... Catholic High has even started putting beehives with their school. I was speaking with a teacher there at my church, or she goes to my church. She's a teacher at one of the Montessori schools, and they were looking into trying to get a beehive with theirs out there around Cantrell and University area. So it's good that they're coming up, and they're around Western Hills Park. There are 19 registered beehives as of the end of 2014. The 2015 numbers, they're short-staffed, and they're losing another one here at the end of the month, so they don't have the 2015 numbers available for me to come here. I apologize to that, but as soon as they can get in, because they've been working hard with the Africanized bees down in southern Arkansas, they are coming in, and... they've also got a little bit of fun stuff going on over in Lono County and a few other points north that are, it's a mold or fungus type thing that gets in the beehives that they're working to take care of and make sure the spread doesn't come over any further than it has.
Thank you.
Again, I apologize for that other
deletion. Mr. Ferguson, did you say, yes, are there nine, do you know how many persons are keeping bees in the city?
In the city of Little Rock? No, sir, I have not asked that.
Is there any
estimation
of that, Mr. Stuckey?
The Central Arkansas Beekeepers Association, which is the Central Arkansas area, so it might include people as far away as Jacksonville and, well, not to Conway, but maybe Mayflower. We have roughly 300 members at this time.
300 members?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Wow.
And a bee yard can have anywhere from one hive to, well, here in the city of Little Rock, I believe it's limited to two unless there's a larger area for square footage by your ordinance. So it can have two, maybe four hives available to it. We're in North Little Rock. My mother's house is in an area. She's got six in her backyard.
Very good.
The old mill.
Sounds great.
Thank you.
I mean,
thank you,
like
Mr. Ferguson.
So I'm supportive. It sounds great.
The it's certainly possible to issue the proclamation, but I think the application, passage of the resolution, just briefly looking at it, would suggest that we are submitting an application. So let's let our staff complete whatever their research is on it, and then we'll bring this back to you. Thank you for bringing
Thank
this
you,
to
Mayor,
our attention.
Mayor, Council.
Director Wyrick has a question or a comment, perhaps, though.
Well, you may have answered it. I was curious to know. I had a swarm of bees that landed on a crepe myrtle tree. It was a big swarm about like this, and by the time I knew somebody that was a beekeeper, and by the time he got there, they'd moved on. So that kind of intrigued me as to how all of this works. But from a resident standpoint, how much land, how much property would you need to have a beehive, and how much separation between residences would it require?
Well, considering that bees will travel up to 3 miles away from their hive to collect nectar or pollen, I could have bees in my backyard, you can have them in your backyard, and they'll wave at each other as they go by.
Yeah. So it's not an issue for residents to...
And they don't just stay in my property,
no. You don't have to wear one of these helmet things and all this stuff in your backyard to keep away from them.
So when we are getting into the hives...
Yes.
I mean, they do kind of take that a little bit as a front, and so we do wear a veil...
Yeah.
...to protect our face area.
Right.
And we use smoke to help calm them. But generally, when a bee is out working a flower in your garden... or working on your cucumber patch, if you come into that area, they're just going to move on to another flower. They're not going to be bothered by you at all. If you go and get into the hive like we do, they do take a little offense to that. The other thing about the swarm, I want to just point out and help everyone to understand that when you see a swarm of bees, that's actually one of the most gentle times that a bee has. They have nothing to protect at that point. They don't have any honey. They don't have a hive. They're actually out looking for a new hive. And they alight on azalea bushes or wherever on a tree. And
very
scouts are going out and looking for a place to go. And it's a fascinating story of how they decide where to go. But we don't have enough time for that. But you know, I could certainly take the time with you. But a swarm is a very gentle time for bees. It may seem scary. And I can imagine if you see 100,000 bees running around, it's kind of a...
It's pretty fascinating.
It's an exciting event.
Right by my front step.
But certainly contact a beekeeper. I actually live in your area, so please call me. I'll come by with a box, put them in the box, and they're very happy to go home with me.
Do you know Robert Sterling, Bob Sterling? He's a beekeeper.
Familiar.
Yeah, I'd called him because I knew he liked to, you know... do the bee thing.
Right.
So by the time he got there, they'd left. They'd gone somewhere else.
It just depends on how quick those scouts find a suitable place for them to live.
They were there for maybe 24 hours.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So it was actually a long time. They're usually only there a couple hours.
Yeah. So. It's pretty fascinating.
Yes,
thank
ma'am.
You.
Director Wright?
Question, quick question. Is this something that you all are have engaged, rather the University of Arkansas Cooperative Extension Service? This seems like something 4-H would do. Okay.
So this is from the Cooperative Extension Service.
Okay.
It's creating a bee-friendly garden.
Okay.
And I recommend everybody go out. It's got all the flowers and plants that the bees like. And so I'd encourage that. John Z, we don't try to say his last name. He is the in-house entomologist or bee person. And I haven't actually talked with him directly about this. I think, did Kay... one of our other contacts was going to make a contact with him, and I'm not sure how that went out.
Seems like a really good 4-H project.
It certainly would be.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll try to make that note to them.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate both of you attending.
Thank you. Thank you.
Before we move on to the next citizen communication, I see that we have a Boy Scout in our midst who's working on probably a merit badge. Is that right? Would you stand up or come forward and tell us briefly who you are and what you're working on? Well, didn't know you were going to get a chance to do this, did you?
No. I'm Bob Kilpatrick. I am a Life Scout, which means I'm like one rank away from Eagle Scout. And I'm one merit badge away from Eagle Scout, which is the one I'm working on right now. It's citizenship in the community. And that's why I'm here, because this is one of the requirements for that.
Where do you go to school?
Catholic High.
Very good. Thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you.
I think his mother might be with him. Is that right? Good. Thank you for being with us. He's a beekeeper too, huh? Oh. Yeah, I understood the principal was getting into bees. Yeah. Well, we got the Boy Scouts and the bees all together. That's good. Okay, thank you very much. The next card we have for citizen communication is Ronnie Jackson on the Nathaniel Hill Community Center complex.
Good morning, good afternoon, Mayor, evening.
Welcome.
Board of Directors, City Manager Bruce Moore. Certainly it's a pleasure to be here this afternoon, and I am coming on behalf of citizens of East Little Rock Neighborhood Association and East Little Rock residents regarding the Nathaniel Hill Community Complex at 2500 East 6th Street. And I also have with me Mr. Greg Simmons and Darlene, his wife, Simmons. They're here as part of our committee as well. Tonight we want to discuss the Nathaniel Hill Complex, and I have distribute a handout for each one of you all. And I apologize, I am a little nervous speaking before you all this evening, so I will say that up front so we can go forward from there. But what is being passed around is some information that is taking place at the Nathaniel Hill Complex as we speak, some outreach things that is taking place there, and things that we support, and you'll get a chance to view those. And while you're passing that around, will you pull up the City Parks and Recreation website.
We only have 3 minutes for this, basically, Mr.
But it would
Jackson,
show you something.
I don't know whether was that asked to be put on there ahead of time.
He wasn't in here when I asked.
I see. Uh-huh. You might want to go ahead and just give us.
Okay. Well, what we're here to point. See is Thank if you. We can have the East Little Rock Community Complex reopened to the residents in our area. Right now, it's being staffed. But the residents, the kids in our area, does not have an opportunity to attend, to do anything at that center. Only Carver School, very minimal, and you have it in front of you here, of what's able to take place there. I also attached some data from the census, the company that does the census for MetroPlan. And they've given you some numbers to look at as well as far as the residents and the kids that are in that area. I'm also looking to get some additional data from the Little Rock School District as regards to the number of students that are in our area as well. And I have a couple of questions for the board, and those are, was the community involved when you all decided to close the Nathaniel Hill Community Complex? Did you all have meetings with the community to find out their thoughts, what they would do? The second question I have is, what is the next step so that we can get started with providing services to our community? We love our community. We're there, and so we want to know if we can have services there so that we don't have to go cross town. Give you an example, and I'll be real brief. There's a tennis court there at the center. There's a ballpark in the very back. The tennis court lists on your website, and that's why I wanted him to pull it up, that there's tennis courts there. Well, court one has a net. Court two and three does not have a net. It has not been taken care of over the years. No one would go there and play tennis. That's just one thing. There's a baseball field in the back that is not being utilized, that could be utilized for some of the area kids. I was in the community this afternoon, and there were about six kids jumping on a trampoline. And I said, hey, I'm going to go and try to talk up for us so we can get our community center back. And the little kid said, great. He went and told everyone, hey, he's going to try to see about getting our community center back. We have a swimming pool in that area. That our kids, and I'm talking, when I say our kids, I'm also looking at the kids that in the Hanger Hill area. They're unable to come locally. They could ride their bikes down to the swimming pool there. Now they would have to go across town to War Memorial or to some other park or community center to swim. We are just like Stevens. I looked at their website today. What they're offering is what we should be offering our residents. I think we're of similar size with the residents in the area, and I think we should have the same benefits that they have without having to leave. As far as our community meetings, we're unable to even have community meetings with our neighborhood association at our community center because it's closed off to us. We have to go to 21st Street. That brings up another population, our seniors. Seniors don't want to travel that time, especially when it gets dark early. So that's all that I have, and I'll entertain any questions from the board.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Moore, do you want to give us an update? And I'm probably not today, but would you provide and the questions that were asked of us?
We will.
All right, very good. There are a couple of questions, Mr. Jackson, that board members have. Director Wright, you're recognized, please.
Well, I was just going to ask if Director Hendricks had been made aware of those concerns. And I think this has been closed for quite some time, hadn't it? And I think if I recall, it was due to the population decrease. And according to the information here, it doesn't seem like it's enough people to warrant that expense. Seems like that was...
I think what we've tried to do is balance, and I'll provide a detailed report of, and as you can see, our staff member gave an outline of what is happening at the center. But we tried to develop a balance of with the population decline, but knowing that's a facility, we still have the St. Vincent's Clinic out there, but we'll see what else. As you can see, the programs that are, we did a report not too long ago about what is actually going on at the center, but we'll provide an update.
Mr. Jackson, let me provide you with a copy of this since you may not have one. Do you
he
have
gave
one?
It to
All
us.
Right.
Yeah.
And may I add, Director Wright, these numbers come from the census from 2000 and 2010. Those are the latest numbers that we have.
Mayor?
Yeah. Yeah.
Will you answer the question in your report, Mr. Moore, as to who attends these? Are the neighborhood kids attending these programs that are outlined in this report?
Well, I can't remember. I think it was in 2014, maybe the last time we gave you a report of what was happening at the center and who was participating. And so we'll update that and look at what else that we might be able to offer. Again, within the confines of, you see the population of 1,400 youth under the age of 17, based on the 2010 census. So, yeah, that's actually all ages is 1,400 and under 500 as far as the youth under 17. So again, we'll talk to our park staff and see what is being offered. I know we try to have one of our rec programs out there in the summer, but
neighborhood kids can attend these.
Great. I just need to get an update on everything that that's operating,
yeah. As well as the hours of operation for the community. Okay, Mr. Jackson. Mr. Moore's going to prepare a report, and we'll make sure that he and staff visit with you about that and get you some information back. Thank you. I'm going to call on Director Hendricks next.
Thank you. I just wanted to share with the board that Mr. Tofrey, along with Mr. Moore, they're working on the improvements, particularly of the park. And I did share that with Mr. Jackson this morning. And Mr. Moore and I have been talking for the past week. Okay, so there will be some improvements out there for you.
At the Nathaniel Hill Park?
At the park.
Okay.
Cheatham Park. No, Cheatham Park.
No, we're in Nathaniel Hill. That's further east.
That's administration. I have nothing to do with that, Mr. Moore.
Oh,
Morrison.
Okay. Yeah. You said Cheatham Park.
Yeah,
okay.
Cheatham Park.
Okay. Okay. That was the other
Mr.
park
Moore's
that I was going to inquire
Moore's
about.
Mr. Moore is a boss, okay?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Director Atcock, you're recognized.
Mr. Moore, I also have visited with this neighborhood association, and Mr. Jackson is the new vice president of Neighborhood Connections. The back page actually tells you what the school children out there can do at this park. And I've talked to some of the youth out there, and they want to be able to go inside to play basketball, and there's no summer playground programs out in that area for these children. Lots of these children are being in homes with grandparents, and so it's very important that they have places to play and people around that care for them and will help them. So I would like Mr. Moore and Mr. Tofrey to see what kind of summer playground program we could put in here, even if we do it with volunteers, because they are sitting out there. We're building a new playground and a new park and a new community center in one part of town, and here's another part of town that we've closed theirs to their children. So, Mr. Moore, I'd like to see a balance, please.
Director Richardson, you're recognized, please.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Mr. Jackson, there's a correlation with your decline in population with poverty rates. You know, in 1990, there's about 56% of young people between the ages of 0 to 17 that live below the poverty rate, below poverty line. Anything above 40% is considered extreme by the federal government. If we fast forward to 2010, look at all the ongoing development and redevelopment of that area, that number dropped to 24%. And we say, oh, that's wonderful. We saw poverty. No, if you look at other correlating parts of the city, you saw an increase. Southwest Little Rock in 1990 had about 20% of young people live below the poverty line. Midtown Little Rock had about 19%. You fast forward to 2010, both of those doubled to more than 40%. So in addition to, you know, we're losing people over there, we're also, there's a population shift. If you look at what happened with the Housing Authority and Hollinsworth development over there, and you look at all the development we've done downtown and eastern part of our community. So we've also had a correlating population shift, poverty shift, when we had these developments and redevelopments. So we may not have the number of young people, and I'm supportive of whatever we want to do to provide services for all young people. I think we need to be able to do that and be in the business providing supports and services for marginalized children, youth, and families. But we need to take a real, real careful look, a close look at the population out there and what warrants supports and services and what level of supports and services we need to have out there for the number of people who still live out in that area.
Well, I live out there in that area.
I know you do, my friend.
Let me tell you, Ken, Director Richardson, I'm sorry, I played football with Ken, but...
tell him how great I was.
We're looking at redeveloping our area.
Right.
With East Villages and things that are happening east of I-30, we're looking at bringing residents back to that area. But we want to offer something for, you know, have something for them to do, for their kids to do. If we go out and say, hey, we want you to buy in our area, but we want to have a community center there.
I agree wholeheartedly. And as somebody who's worked with gang intervention prevention programs in the early 90s, mid-90s, there was a definite need for those types of supports and services. But as you had these population shifts, there became less a need to have gang intervention prevention programs because we didn't have the gang members over in that area like we did in the early, mid-90s. So I'm supportive of us having supports and services. I think it needs to match the need. We need to be able to do a fair assessment and determine what we actually need to have out there.
Ronnie. Thank you, Mr. Jackson.
All right, thank you, Mayor.
All right, the next card I have is from Mrs. Peggy Wright and Reverend Howard Browse on the house demolition and weedlots. Is this an agenda item? Is this on our agenda?
No,
what is the location of the house?
2505 Maple.
Just a minute.
Let's see this. Is it possible to put this on screen? No.
Show him. Started with Mr. Moore.
Mr. Moore.
Hold on just a second. Yeah, it's item 33.
Item 33. Yeah, if you'll just have a seat, please. We'll call you up on this. You accidentally filled out the wrong card.
Oh,
so okay. we're gonna talk about it here when we get to that particular item on the agenda.
Okay.
Okay, the next card I have is from Whitney Patterson.
Good evening. There's my time. I was here last week, and I spoke about an infrastructure project on Battery Street that at one time, or I guess the last time it was presented to the public, was a part of the current funding cycle, and it's been removed. And Mayor Siddle, you asked for a report from staff, and I just wanted to follow up with that.
Well, if you'll follow up with Mr. Moore, he'll be able to tell you the rationale behind what has happened on that. I don't know if you would.
Well, I wasn't here, but I do have a report that's coming to you all, I think, next Friday that we'll share. But I should have it completed by next Friday.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you so much.
The next card I have is from Annie Abrams. Ms. Abrams, welcome.
Mr. Mayor, City Manager, members of the board, the ward representative board members, and the at-large. Most times when I come, I'm coming because you have an issue on the agenda, but I came to thank you all. I've been watching at home. Every time you're on, I'm at home watching and doing two or three other things. So I got my eye on you whether you see me here or not. But I came to thank you. And Irma, I want to thank you because I was ready if you had gotten them to vote against that sidewalk over there on our house. I had my ammunition ready. Thank you so very much for helping that be a unanimous vote that you all cast. The second thing that I wanted to share, an observation that I think I shared with the mayor and the governor. This is the capital city. And I'm monitoring, as I always do. I'm concerned that we are becoming a rental city, high-rise rental, individual houses rental, small apartments rental. And the futuristic part of me is we are not maintaining home ownership. And one who fought so hard for our taxes to be raised, the penny tax, that when you don't have homeowners, that's the majority of your revenue base, and also those homeowners are the ones that you'll have to vote on you all. People who are renters, particularly high-rise renters in precincts, watch it. They don't always come and vote. And when you are not going to be having revenue to do all the services that we need, and you're not going to have the density, then I'll be out to the State House about how the congressional lines will be drawn first. And next, school zones and all of that is tied to density. And when you don't have density growth, you don't have income revenue that's going to be there for the future. So that's one of the things that I wanted to just, as an old 84-year-old woman, tell you. I may not be here, but you'll remember this. Don't become a Manhattan, New York. Okay. The next thing I wanted to say is that when you voted tonight, I have prayed that we didn't have an accident over there with the children at the board where I am and been there watching it. That street is named Roosevelt. You old enough, you 85 and I'm 84. That it was named after Roosevelt because he couldn't get back to Warm Springs. It don't matter to me. Warm Springs because his arthritis, polio, and all of that, he went on over to Hot Springs. So that's why we named that street Roosevelt. Some old folks were sitting up there like y'all, and they changed the name of the street because of the issue. The thing that I want to fuss at you about a little bit, Mr. Moore, we need, with these mosquitoes that everybody talking about, I haven't seen the man come through and spray in Ward 1, Irma. At-large members, check on it for me, because if they're over there in other areas, I'll hold you responsible for that. The last thing is, I'm so tired of sweeping my street, and the street sweeper was there twice last year. Has that been cut out of the budget and I just didn't catch it? Okay, so it's not out. He better be over here before too long, and I better start seeing them kill the mosquitoes before they get started. Thank you so very much. I'm sorry I used more than 3 minutes.
Thank you, Ms. Abrams. You never mentioned the Wright Avenue neighborhood plan, which is what you told me you were going to talk about.
Well, I
something wrong. I said, I better see about these other things. Thank you for the plan you approved in Ward 1 for the Wright Avenue Neighborhoods Association. 5-year plan.
That was a compliment from Ms. Abrams about the Wright Avenue Neighborhood Plan. Thank you. Director Wright, yes, you're recognized, please.
Mayor, Ms. Abrams brought up an issue that is continuing to be an issue in our city, and that is in the multifamily development. And I've been doing some research on that, and I've got the data here. And I mentioned this to Mr. Moore, that I would like to see some type of report where we have done some research on multifamily development and the impact that it has on our neighborhoods, property values, taxes, crime, all of these things, because the research that I'm reading says that a lot of these perceptions are not true. They're myths. And a lot of the reaction stems from emotion and the misconception that this type of housing is not desirable. But all of the research that I've done says that this is the trend that we're in, and that single-family residential development is not something that we're going to see on the horizon anytime soon. And if these type projects are going to continue to come forward, then I think we need all the information that we can get to in order to share with our citizens so that they understand. And I read in one of these documents about the tax base and how these developments pay a lot of taxes. Well, we need to know if that's true and if this is going to definitely impact the revenue that we are able to bring into our city. And this is because these are very important factors. And I have, you know, several developments going on in Ward 6 and more maybe on the horizon, and I can anticipate the stress that's going to be felt by the property owners in the single-family neighborhoods that are surrounding this. So I'd like to have some factual information that I can pull from whenever I'm trying to address their concerns. So I don't know if we need to have a formalized study or if our staff has done some research, but if you have it, I'd like to receive it.
Director Wright, if you would make your information available to staff and perhaps also make it available to the board.
Pass that to the manager.
And let the board have a copy of this as well.
Yeah,
and
then pass it to the manager.
We can ask staff to give us an update on that, please. Director Hendricks, do you have a comment?
It's a comment on what Director Wright has said. I think I would say 2 months ago or so, is that this issue came up particularly out in the west part of the city. And I mentioned to one of the speakers at the podium that this is it. Young people are not buying houses like we did. And it's going to be with us. So people are just going to have to accept it. Or as I suggest to some people, they call me, if you don't like it, move. I know that's cold, but that's real.
I like to phrase it a little better.
Okay, we can now move on to other items on our agenda, which are items 17 through 32, please. First reading.
An ordinance to accept the Canis Pride annexation to add certain lands to the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to approve a plan zoning development, establish a plan commercial district titled Orlando Heights, short form PCD, located at 101 North University Avenue, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to approve a plan zoning development, establish a plan residential district titled The Residence at Pettaway, short form PDR, located at 2020 Vance Street, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to approve a plan zoning development, establish a plan office district titled Little Rock Plastic Surgery Center, revised short form PDO, located at 15,104 to 15,122 Cantrell Road, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to repeal ordinance number 21,119 of October the 5th, 2015, and revoke a plan zoning district titled Arkansas Systems Track 4 Long Form PCD, located at 17,400 Chenal Parkway, Little Rock, Arkansas, and an ordinance reclassifying property located at 17,400 Chenal Parkway in the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled The Villas at Chenal, revised long-form PDR, located at Chenal Valley Drive at my mouth is moving before my brain is. LaMarche Drive, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Lowe's at Canis and Bowman, long-form PCD, located on the northwest corner of Canis Road and Bowman Road, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to amend the land use plan at 16,100 Chenal Parkway, and for the purposes, an ordinance to repeal ordinance number 18,097 of September the 21st, 1999, and revoke a planned zoning district titled Riverside Motors Short Form PDC, located at 16,100 Chenal Parkway, Little Rock, Arkansas, and an ordinance reclassifying property located at 16,100 Chenal Parkway in the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled Deal Short Form PDR, located at the southeast corner of East 9th and Cumberland Streets, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for other purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled Shandridge Park Development, short form PDR, located at 2 to 12 Shandridge Park Drive, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for other purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled 719 North Spruce Street, short form PDC, located at 719 North Spruce Street, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for other purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Cal's Parking Debt, short form PCD, located at 333 President Clinton Avenue, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for other purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Rebel Kettle Brewery and Restaurant, short form PCD, located at 822 East 6th Street, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for other purposes, an ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled SCK Place LLC, short form PDR, located at 6819 to 6823 Honeysuckle Lane, Little Rock, Arkansas, amending the official zoning map of the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for other purposes, in order to dispense with the requirement of competitive bidding and to authorize the city manager to enter into a sole source contract with Edge Wave in the total amount of $30,691.51 plus taxes and fees for the purchase of iPrism web filtering service and maintenance, and for the purposes, first reading.
There's a motion and a second to suspend the rules and place this ordinance on second reading. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Second reading, please.
An ordinance to accept the Canis Pride annexation to add certain lands to the city of Little Rock, Arkansas. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Orlando Heights, short form PCD, located at 101 North University Avenue. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled The Residence at Petaway, short form PDR, located at 2020 Vance Street. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned office district titled Little Rock Plastic Surgery Center, revised short form PDO, located at 15,104 to 15,122 Cantrell Road. An ordinance to repeal ordinance number 21,119 of October the 5th, 2015, and to revoke a planned zoning district titled Arkansas Systems Track 4 Long Form PCD, located at 17,400 Chenal Parkway, Little Rock, Arkansas, and an ordinance reclassifying property located at 17,400 Chenal Parkway. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled The Villas at Chenal, revised long form PDR, located at Chenal Valley Drive and LaMarche Drive. I've only said that word 600 times in my life, but for some reason I can't do that tonight. I apologize. An ordinance to approve a plan zoning development established plan commercial district titled Lowe's at Canis and Bowman, long form PCD, located on the northwest corner of Canis and Bowman Roads. An ordinance to amend the land use plan at 16,100 Chenal Parkway. An ordinance to repeal ordinance number 18,097 of September the 21st, 1999, and revoke a planned zoning district titled Riverside Motors, short form PDC, located at 16,100 Chenal Parkway, Little Rock, Arkansas, and an ordinance reclassifying property located at 16,100 Chenal Parkway. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled Deal, short form PDR, located on the southeast corner of East 9th and Cumberland Streets. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled Shandridge Park Development, short form PDR, located at 2-12 Shandridge Park Drive. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled 719 North Spruce Street, long short form PDC, located at 719 North Spruce Street. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Cowles Parking Debt, short form PCD, located at 333 President Clinton Avenue. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Rebel Kettle Brewery and Restaurant, short form PCD, located at 822 East 6th Street. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled SCK Place LLC, short form PDR, located at 6819 to 6823 Honeysuckle Lane. An ordinance to dispense with the requirement of competitive bidding and to authorize the city manager to enter into a sole source contract with Edge Wave in a total amount of $30,691.51 plus taxes for the purchase of iPrism web filtering service and maintenance. Second reading.
And the rules in place on third and final reading.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed saying nay. Third and final reading, please.
An ordinance to accept the Canis Pride annexation to certain lands to the city of Little Rock, Arkansas. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Orlando Heights, short form PCD, located at 101 North University Avenue. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled The Residence at Petaway, short form PDR, located at 2020 Vance Street. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned office district titled Little Rock Plastic Surgery Center, revised, short form PDO, located at 15,104 to 15,122 Cantrell Road. An ordinance to repeal ordinance number 21,119 of October the 5th, 2015, and to revoke a planned zoning district titled Arkansas Systems Track 4 Long Form PCD, located at 17,400 Chenal Parkway, Little Rock, Arkansas, and an ordinance reclassifying property located at 17,400 Chenal Parkway. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled The Villas at Chenal, revised long form PDR, located on Chenal Valley Drive and LaMarche Drive. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Lowe's and Canis Bowman Long Form PCD, located on the northwest corner of Canis and Bowman Roads. An ordinance to amend the land use plan at 16,100 Chenal Parkway. An ordinance to repeal ordinance number 18,097 of September the 21st, 1999, and revoke a planned zoning district titled Riverside Motors, short form PDC, located at 16,100 Chenal Parkway, Little Rock, Arkansas, and an ordinance reclassifying property located at 16,100 Chenal Parkway. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled Deal, short form PDR, located on the southeast corner of East 9th and Cumberland Streets. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled Shandridge Park Development, short form PDR, located at 2-12 Shandridge Park Drive. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled 719 North Spruce Street, short form PDC, located at 719 North Spruce Street. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Cowles Parking Deck, short form PCD, located at 333 President Clinton Avenue. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned commercial district titled Rebel Kettle Brewery and Restaurant, short form PCD, located at 822 East 6th Street. An ordinance to approve a planned zoning development establish a planned residential district titled SCK Place LLC, short form PDR, located located at 6819 to 6823 Honeysuckle Lane, an ordinance to dispense with the requirement of competitive bidding and to authorize the city manager to enter into a sole source contract with Edge Wave in the total amount of $30,691.51 plus taxes and fees for the purchase of iPrism Web Filtering Service and Maintenance. Third and final reading.
Okay, we've had three readings on these ordinances. I just recently received a card on item 19, so let me call for a vote on all of the ordinances as read, with the exception of item 19. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. The ordinances have passed.
I think 19 may be a mistake, Mayor. I don't think Mr. Webb wanted that card going in for that item. I think there may be some miscommunication.
We're going to have to vote on it separately. Mr. Webb, did you want to say something about this item? All right, and let me call now for a vote on item 19. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. That ordinance is also passed. We can now move on to a reading for ordinance number 33. First reading, please. We'll clear the room.
An ordinance to condemn a certain structure in the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, with structural fire and health hazards, providing for summary abatement procedures, directing the city manager to take such action as is necessary to raise and remove said structure, to declare an emergency, and for other purposes. First reading.
We suspend the rules and place on second reading.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to suspend the rules and place this ordinance on second reading. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Second reading, please.
An ordinance to condemn a certain structure in the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, with structural fire and health hazard, providing for summary abatement procedures, directing the city manager to take such action as is necessary to raise and remove said structure, to declare an emergency. Second reading.
Move to suspend the rules and place on third and final reading.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to suspend the rules and place this ordinance on third and final reading. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Third and final reading, please.
An ordinance to condemn a certain structure in the city of Little Rock, Arkansas, with structural fire and health hazard, providing for summary abatement procedures, directing the city manager to take such action as is necessary to raise and remove said structure, to declare an emergency. Third and final reading.
Yeah, thank you. I've got two cards on this. The first card is to speak in favor of this ordinance is Mr. Emmett Willis.
Mayor and board.
If Mr. Willis, Mayor, if you'll pull that up just a little bit. There you go. Thank you.
I have no, you know, just let I've already provided the information to staff, and at this point I can yield to whatever they've.
Did you wish to see that this house be demolished? Is that correct?
No, I wish you, that in contacting and getting with your city office. And
do you own the property?
Yes, I do own the property.
Okay. Well, yeah.
I'm just coming back.
You said you wish to speak of the ordinance, which means to demolish it.
No, not to demolish it.
All right. You wish to speak against the ordinance.
I wish to speak against it.
All right. If you go ahead and tell us what your position is on it, please.
Well, I provided the plan. I don't know if you have a copy of my rehab plan.
They said it wasn't sufficient.
I'd like to hear from staff.
Mr. Moore, do you have a staff?
Yes, Mr. Garland, come forward.
Mr. Garland, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor, Vice Mayor Hines, members of the board, city manager. We did meet with, we being the staff, met with Mr. Willis on April 21st. We asked him for a redevelopment plan, current contact information, and the financial capacity, or some reference to the financial capacity to do the rehab. On April 25th, he did provide us a rehab plan that says he would get the property completely rehabbed in 132 days. Here this afternoon, we received a letter from a Mr. Johnny Harris, who says that Mr. Emmett Willis, as well as PFI Inc., has access to a $70,000 line of credit at Regions Bank. We just received this today. We also had a stop work order issued on the property by the building codes on April 29th. There seemed to have been, according to some code enforcement pictures there on April 27th, some demolition work having started prior to coming back to the board. And we also received a recommendation from the building codes group that this property should be demolished.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Garland. Mr. Willis, do you have any other follow-up comments on this?
Not at all.
Was that letter from Regions Bank, or was that just from one of your partners?
From our partner.
All right. Yes. Do you have a letter from Regions Bank?
No, we don't.
Okay.
No. It was going to be very intense in the details and the information of financial, but we have the funds that would be available. We have a line of credit along with other miscellaneous cash to complete the project. And at that point, we would like to renovate the property, and now it's in your hands. So,
thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
I have some people who wish to also speak about this matter. Mrs. Peggy Wright. I guess if we've got three different individuals who wish to speak, I'll just call you in order. Mrs. Wright, you're first, please.
All right. The rehabilitation plan, and he had the money.
Mayor Stadola, Mr. Moore.
If you'll, there we
Mayor
go.
Mayor Stadola, Mr. Moore, to the City Board of Directors. Good evening. I'm Peggy Wright. I'm with the Love Neighborhood Association, and we are here, Mr. Browse and Ms. Louise Baltimore, because we have a lot of problems in our area, in our neighborhood, with old houses demolished, dilapidated houses that need to be demolished. This house in particular, I have lived down the street from this house for 43 years, and for the past 18 to 20 years, it has been a problem in the neighborhood. There's been several owners. Every time the city comes up to do something with this house, it goes to a new owner. There's a new owner all of a sudden. And then we go back to this vicious cycle of nothingness. You know, nothing is done. My husband and I have cut the yard twice there. I passed pictures around, if you've seen those. And I took those pictures today before the city came and boarded the house up. But there's rats, not mice, giant rats. And my husband and I, we put out poison. My dog, he kills them sometime, lay them on step for me because he know that we're having problems with them. So he helps us out the best he can. But this house has been an ongoing problem. And different owners take the house and say they're going to rehab it, and then they do nothing. And transits have moved into the house, and my husband and I have even cleaned up the yard where there was just sacks of human waste on the yard. But we live a house down, so we try to clean it up because it makes our property look bad. It's terrible. And I just don't know how many times that this house is going to pass through different hands. And when the city gets involved, seems like there's a new owner. There's somebody else come by and say, we're going to rehab this. And if they were going to rehab it, seemed to me like they would clean it up, cut the grass, or do something. This house is rotten. The studs are rotten. The floor is rotten. And from what I can see, the only thing that needs to be done is torn down and start and built all over. And if this person is going to rehab this house, it needs to be done yesterday. I have spoke with people myself about the house. It's falling down, and if you look on there, those pictures that you had up there is not like the ones I took. There's a jack there that's with the tube before that's holding up the roof, and it's really bad. There's mold in there, and there's several people that's been there and said the house was not rehabable. I don't know why, but LNA is requesting the city directors to compel slumlords and deadbeat property owners to be held responsible for their properties. There are many properties in our area that's like that. Like I said, in my opinion, it's not rehabable. It needs to come down. LNA appreciates all the past, present, and future help from the city, and we hope we can continue to change the image of our neighborhood. We have bought our own riding lawn mowing tools, and we cut weed lots. We've been trying to improve the neighborhood because it's a mess. And it has been a mess. Crime has been through the roof, and it's just a terrible place. But it is getting better, but it needs a lot of work. And there's a lot of old houses there that needs to come down. There's a lot of homes there that where owners, they live out of town, and we can't seem to get anything done about that. Some of the neighbors will cut the front yard, but they don't cut the back. And the properties look like a jungle in the city. Can you look at that? Now,
thank you, Ms. Wright. Is there anything?
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. We have some other people who wish to speak. Mr. Browse, Reverend Browse.
Mayor Stokola, Vice Mayor, City Manager, and all the board members. We were told at one time that we were going to get the weed lots to cut in our neighborhoods. And I have, matter of fact, I talked to the new person who was overseer, David Jackson, and we had a conversation about a week and a half ago, and he said we would get some list of the lots to cut. But I have since gone through the neighborhood, and I've seen that some lots have been cut. The lots are exceeding 10 inches, 15 inches, and even higher than that. But there are some that's being cut, but we are not being contacted at all.
Well, we can, Mr. Moore, if you'll have one of our staff people get with Reverend Browse on the weed lots, please. Thank you, Mr. Browse.
You've got my number, have you not?
Ms. Baltimore, is it Baltimore? Do you have anything you would like to add to this discussion?
I concur.
You concur with the two previous speakers? Okay, very good. Thank you. Yes, Director Hendricks, go ahead, please.
Thank you. I wanted to ask Mr. Ed. I'll wait till he finished talking to Mr. Moore. Bruce, I need to talk to Ed.
Mr. Garland, Ed. Director Hendricks has a question for you.
Yes, Director Hendricks.
Looking at the agenda, it seems that staff has approved it. What's your opinion about trying to do something with this house? Is that appropriate, Mr. Moore? It looks bad.
Director Hendricks, let me just answer. The staff is recommending moving forward with demolishing the house. We have not changed that our recommendation.
Okay. Thank you. That's what I agree with the recommendation.
Vice Mayor Hines?
Come back. So that letter wasn't from Regions Bank?
That letter was not from Regions Bank. It was from Johnny Harris.
Okay. That's all I need to know.
And he referenced that Mr. Willis is a family member.
Thank you.
Okay, we've had three readings of the ordinance. All in favor of the passage of ordinance number 33, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. The ordinance is passed. So, Mr. Willis, the house has been condemned and it's going to be torn down. We'll put a lien on the property if you don't tear it down first. So sometimes people get it torn down faster and with less money than we spend on it. So just a word to the wise, you might want to talk with Mr. Garland about that. Thank you. Okay, we have one final ordinance on our agenda.
Mayor, there's an emergency clause.
Oh, excuse me. There's an emergency clause on item 33. All in favor of the emergency clause indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. The emergency clause is also passed.
Mayor, you have M1 as well.
Okay. You want to go ahead and read M1?
An ordinance to amend Little Rock, Arkansas, ordinance number 20,824 of December 23rd, 2013, to correct an inaccurate legal description, to declare an emergency, and for the purposes, first reading.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to suspend the rules and place this ordinance on second reading. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Second reading, please.
An ordinance to amend Little Rock, Arkansas, ordinance number 20,824 of December 23rd, 2013, to correct to correct an inaccurate legal description to declare an emergency. Second reading.
We suspend the rules and place on third and final reading.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to suspend the rules and place this ordinance on third and final reading. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Third and final reading, please.
An ordinance to amend Little Rock, Arkansas, ordinance number 20,824 of December 23rd, 2013, to correct an inaccurate legal description to declare an emergency. Third and final reading.
All in favor of the passage of the ordinance indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. The ordinance is passed. We can now move on to ordinance 35, which requires
emergency clause.
Oh, I keep missing those. Sorry about that. On the emergency clause, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. The emergency clause is also passed. Okay, we can move on to item 35, which is to dissolve a sewer improvement district. I'm going to go ahead and open up the public hearing. Ask for first reading, please.
An ordinance to dissolve sewer improvement district number 147 of Little Rock, Arkansas, and for the purposes, first reading.
We suspend the rules and place on second reading.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to suspend the rules and place the ordinance on second reading. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Second reading, please.
An ordinance to dissolve sewer improvement district number 147 of Little Rock, Arkansas. Second reading.
We suspend the rules and place on third and final reading.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to suspend the rules and place this ordinance on third and final reading. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Third and final reading, please.
An ordinance to dissolve sewer improvement district number 147 of Little Rock, Arkansas. Third and final reading.
Okay, we've had three readings on this ordinance. Is there anyone here who wishes to speak either for or against the dissolution of sewer improvement district 147? Anybody who wishes to speak either in favor or opposed to this ordinance? Hearing none, let me go ahead and close the public hearing. All in favor of the passage of ordinance number 35 indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Ordinance number 35 is also approved. Relative to the next item on our agenda, appointments and reappointments to boards and commissions, two of our board members, Director Fortson and Director Kazort, were not able to be with us tonight, and they had asked that we hold that I hold this. So we will go ahead and do this next at our next meeting. So that concludes the agenda items. Director Wright has a comment or a question. Go
yes.
ahead, please.
Mr. Moore, I held this until you got back in town, and I let you get a little break or rest. But I'm going to have to put you on the spot because my constituents have put me on the spot. And the scenario that was put to me was, what if businesses in the River Market were being plagued by transients, people that were basically homeless, and that people that were revealing themselves to their customers, and otherwise camping out on their properties, which is in effect driving away their business and making customers not want to patronize their businesses. And the question was put to me, what if this was happening in the River Market, what would be the city's response? And so I told them that I would bring this issue before you. I've talked with you all before about the homeless issue that I'm having along Colonel Glenn, at my Kroger store, at the, formerly it was Kentucky Fried Chicken, but it's now a Shark's. And I also have a Chinese restaurant in there. And there are several other businesses in there as well. But these businesses are being basically plagued. And I know this is true because I patronize them. And while I was in the drive-thru, I've had people come up to my car panhandling. And one of the owners of one of the restaurants was accused by a homeless person of stealing her car. Now, it was the business owner's car, but the business owner was harassed by the homeless person, and when the police got there, the homeless person made the allegation that the owner had stolen their car. This person had to produce their credentials to show that this was their car that they owned. It was, in their words, it was humiliating, it was demeaning, and it was as far as they're concerned, uncalled for that a taxpaying business owner that's trying to provide jobs in our city had to be accosted in that way on their own property and required to show their credentials, whereas this other person can walk up and down the street and harass their customers and there's no penalty for it. So I told them that I would bring this before you again because I've tried to get you all to put the homeless outreach services out there, and I have not gotten any response. I have not seen any changes.
Yeah, and I've got a report coming to you. We tried a pilot program, and I'll tell you the results of that in this report. So I'll it is a challenge in that area, and we did some direct outreach, but we'll sit back down with our housing unit and LRPD and see if we can aggressively try to approach this. But we did some outreach in that area and was really not very successful, but I'll give you those numbers.
Well, I knew that you would have a difficult time because these people are making money panhandling, and they're making a pretty good living. And if they're doing this successfully, and I try to share with people when I talk with them that they don't need to give these people money, that will encourage them to stay in the area, and that's what we're having. And we have people living on the parking lots. They have their cart, and they have all their bedding. I've even seen a recliner out on Kroger's parking lot where they just camped out. And, I mean, these people have rights as well as, you know, they're running a business. And people are frightened of this. And these restaurants, I know they come up and panhandle at your car because they've done it to me. But I have not had one of them expose themselves. But this is what one of the owners is saying, that this one woman exposed herself to her customer when they refused to give her money. So I'm asking you to take some action.
Director Wright, there are a variety of those kinds of occurrences, some of which are criminal violations and some of which are not. I know in talking with our homeless contractor that we've had our vans out there to try and pick people up. We can't force them to get into a van. We can't force them to go to the Day Resource Center. There's not, you know, a lot of people, and myself included, don't like to see the panhandling that goes on, but asking somebody for money is not a crime. Mm-hmm. Yeah, aggressive panhandling is, and there's a fine line between the two as it relates to that. I can tell you that there are lots of homeless people downtown. They go to the River Market, as a matter of fact, and the security there has to deal with the issue. So it's not absent from any part of the city. We have homeless throughout the entire city.
I agree.
And we try to work with them. We try to get them help. We're doing a very improved. We're improving that substantially, and we've got probably 150 that show up for breakfast and lunch every morning and afternoon at Jericho Way, the Day Resource Center. And they're working with the shelters. I know that we try to do that with that, and I look forward to Mr. Moore's report on it. But again, trying to get them help, you've got to have a willing participant.
I agree.
And of course, they can't trespass either, so that's a violation.
Exactly.
So those are some things that where law enforcement can take some action.
I'd appreciate any efforts that you can provide, and because I want that corridor to stabilize, and these businesses have been there for a while, and I was just really grateful to see that when my Kentucky Fried Chicken closed, another restaurant opened up immediately. So that's beneficial to the community out there, so I don't want to lose them. Thank you.
Did someone pass out this photograph that everyone got a copy of? What? Pardon? All right. Director Wyrick, you're recognized, please.
Thank you, Mayor. Doris and I and some others have been talking about items that are pulled to the curb in some of our wards, and I asked for a report out of our new and improved 311 system, and it's several pages thick, just for Ward 7. The oldest reports that I had was January 19th, and I think maybe this was scrubbed a little bit before I saw it, but anyway, 119 and 125, there were two locations that was for trash, rubbish, and debris on premise, and the group that's supposed to take care of it is the premise group. Mr. Moore, if we turn in a report of trash, rubbish, and debris on premise, how long should we give the premise group to take care of that?
The Director Wyrick, one of the things that's going to you're going to see in your report is a lot of the housing and especially premise types of violations, and they're in that case there are multiple. So the trash should be a certain period. If it's a premise violation, as you know, we've got to give a notice.
It says and, debris on premise.
Right.
I couldn't say it right.
Right. And again, one of the things, and you and I have talked about this, is especially in the ones from January, and I met with the group last Wednesday, to this is housing and public works, and one of the things you're going to see going forward is another category that gives sort of a status. Here's what we've done. We've issued a notice or we've issued a citation. And in that initial report, that you didn't have that. So to answer your question, if it's trash, depending on the size of it, if it's something that is just basic trash, then we should get that up fairly quickly. But
that should we expect a week?
Again, I would my expectation
almost
is
4 months on those two. So.
Right, and I think the issue is in some of those cases when there are multiple, some of it's been addressed, but because some of it hasn't, it just shows it's still open. So that's one of the things I'm trying to clean up on these reports. If trash has been, if it's been taken care of by Public Works, it shouldn't still show trash on that. Open request. So
okay.
I'm starting to meet again with them every Wednesday to make sure that the ones that are outstanding that we're addressing first.
Okay. What about an on-call bulky item special pickup request? It was assigned to solid waste on 3-1.
Again, I've often said bulky items should be within 72 hours.
Exactly.
Right.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure you hadn't backed off of that. Okay, well, that one's been there for a while. And then what should we expect on knuckle boom pickups?
That can be anywhere to 30 to 45 days.
I thought you'd said that, 30 to 45 days. Okay, now on those particular things, I don't know what they are. And this is the one that I sent you an email about, this one that's on here over in Otter Creek. It was opened up on 321. It says knuckle boom pickup, and it was assigned to solid waste. So it's about time for you to pick that up, isn't it? 30 to 45 days?
Day being May 3rd, we should be. It should be.
Hopefully you did it pretty quick, because Otter Creek is really complaining. They said they had several. Well, we just need to get a handle on this. As Doris and I have talked about, we're seeing stuff pulled out to the road, and if it's going to take us a week or 2 weeks to pick this up, and if it's going to take 30 to 45 days for a knuckle boom truck to come out, I'm wondering, particularly in the Otter Creek area, if these people would pull it to the curb if they knew it's going to have to sit there for 45 days. If we could come up with some guidelines to let our residents know. I know there are some people that don't really care, they'll just pull it out anyway. But in a neighborhood like Otter Creek, I think if they knew they was going to have to look at it for 30 to 45 days, maybe they'd wait a little bit before they pulled it out.
I'll give you an example. A good friend of mine that lives in Otter Creek had a tree that was cut up and put on the curb by a tree service. And he called 311, and they told him 30 days. And so he sent, he was going to take advantage of our friendship. He calls me or sends me a text and says, hey, I called 311, and they said it's going to take 30 days to pick up this tree. And it's not a small, it's a big tree that he got cut up. And so our operators are, they have a list of different categories, and based on the season and so forth, where we are, they're supposed to give you a range. In this case, a tree cut up on the side of the road was going to be 30 days. So I asked him, I told him it's probably 30 to 45 days, and I said, well, why didn't you have the tree service take the tree with them? And he was very plain. He said, well, they're a small business, and I was trying to help them out. And so that's some of our challenges, the expectations of our citizens, and that picture that Director Hendricks passed along, that was an owner that kicked somebody out of their rental unit, put everything on the curb, and the expectation is that we're going to pick it up. And that's one of our biggest challenges in something like that. But and Director Hendricks' thought is that that owner should be – that we should charge that owner in some way. Well, in order to do that, we've got to issue a notice. And that means that stays on there for 7 days, and then we go back, and if it's still there, we issue a citation. And so all the clock's running, but the only way we're able to actually charge that owner is once we go through the process. Now, that got picked up, but because we didn't go through the notice procedures, the city attorney's office has opined that we can't put a lien on that property. So, you know, I do think I'm working on revamping the 311 division. Don't have all those thoughts put together, but I think it's time to potentially relocate that out of the police department. I think that's where it needed to be initially. But 311 and 911 is really totally different. 311 is more detail from a customer service neighborhood perspective. 911 is we're trying to respond and dispatch. So we're working on a plan to hopefully, and by doing that, hopefully that we're, as you all know, we mainly deal with public works and housing. So I'm trying to figure out a way to pull those together from a 311 perspective. And I think you'll see some improvement, especially with our new software.
Yeah, well, I knew it was looking bad, and Doris did too. Okay, so you're going to work on that. The second item on my list is the spraying of roadway. And I sent you an email about a property owner that you got last year and killed his grass that on a piece of property he's trying to maintain and grow grass. And you said that would never happen again, and you got him this year again, and you killed two of his honeysuckle plants that were about $48 a piece that he wants to be reimbursed for. But I think the more serious part of it, I mean, that was bad that you told him you wouldn't do it, and then you did it again. But the fact that there seems to be no rhyme or reason for when they spray and when they don't spray. They got in front of my property that I mow. I pay to mow it twice a week, and not twice a week, once every 2 weeks. Obviously not twice a week, but every 2 weeks. And there's no ditch. It's flat land. They got my property, and then you're going down the road, and then there's a ditch where nobody maintains it, and they didn't spray that. And I think you've told me in the past, last year when we had a powwow about this, that is the property owner's property and that you're just trying to help them out with taking care of cleaning the right-of-way. Is that what you told me?
Pretty much.
And so we ought to have the option to spray or mow. And I don't want my property sprayed, and I know there's a lot of people that maintain the right-of-ways because the city can't do it, and they don't want their sprayed. So I think there needs to be a plan to try to figure out how to handle that better. I think you're done spraying for the year. Is that true?
Well, actually, as a result of, if I go out to an area and the staff is out there and they hear me say this isn't going to happen again, I'm really surprised when it happens again. But the I think I sent this note to you that I'm just revamping it and just saying that we're only going to spray by request, and then it will only occur along the undeveloped property.
But you see, the problem is where you sprayed the right of way, it's a field, but I maintain the right of way. So it'll look pretty for everybody when they drive through there. But it's an open field that's behind there. But they have sprayed some property where there was an existing home as well. I just, you know, if you're going to spray, then you need to give notice to the people that you're coming through, and they can put a sign up or they can do something. I kind of like the idea that the spraying would happen on demand, and then you'd be sure and get the property that needs to be done.
And that's what we're going to do going forward.
Thank you.
Mr. Moore, just as a follow-up to that, I know I had I inquired from a tree service about cutting down a tree, and they gave me a quote and two quotes. One quote was to cut the tree down and take it off, and a cheaper quote just to cut it down and leave it on the side of the curb. I didn't do that, needless to say. But I think we should direct these tree services that's an inappropriate way to be bidding these things, that we do not pick up trees like that. So I think if we would get a note out or a letter out to these tree services, please, that's not the appropriate way to be quoting to citizens about how to get a tree down, because obviously most people are going to take the cheaper way out of that, thinking the city's going to pick that up. And thinking about picking things up, I have driven by on Cantor Road now, I guess, for maybe 3 months, and there is a utility pole that was knocked down, and it's been laying down there for about 3 months. I think it's probably one of our utility company's poles, and if we could get them directed to pick it up finally, it would be nice. I know that's not our responsibility, but we should find out who's been leaving it there for as long as it's been there.
Mayor,
did you narrow down
thing?
I
don't want to cast aspersions at this time as to whose it is, but
no,
I bet
just
you.
The address.
Oh,
I mean.
It's over there by the warehouses, right after the viaduct.
Mayor, we've had some people that, we have a lot of trees in my area, and when we had storms come through, then people have come and cut trees and pulled them to the curb. I know one time we had a semi-length amount of trees that were cut up and brought to the right-of-way, and the city charged the property owner for picking those up. So if it's a cut tree situation like that, then the city should charge for picking them up. If it's semi-length, that's a whole lot of trees.
Director Hendricks, you're recognized, please.
I'll be brief. You were asking about the photo. Is this the one that you were asking about?
I think you got a different one. I've got similar.
Yeah,
one.
That's the same one. As I said earlier, Mr. Moore did pick that up, but you all will be getting a draft from Mr. Carpenter that we can deal with this, because as I said to Mr. Moore, we need to start making some money. And talking about the trees, we can pick up if they are so big in diameter, but when they get bigger than that, I think that the people need to hire somebody to take them off. And if we can move this as fast as we did with parking in the yard, we passed that with no question. But I said to Mr. Moore, he needs help, and he can't do it all by himself. And I think that the ordinance that Tom's preparing, if we'll take a look at it, I hope you all pass it. It's not for me, it's for the community.
Very good. Thank you, Director Hendricks. Director Wright, you're recognized, please.
Mr. Moore, can you provide me with a schedule for how we cut, or some information on how we cut our thoroughfares? Like down Barrow Road and Canis Road, but especially Barrow, you know, we have sidewalks in there, and they're overgrown with grass and things like that. And you know, I submitted a proposal to you about a reentry program to have a crew, just like we do with the sidewalks, to cut our thoroughfares in each of our wards, and not every street, but the main thoroughfares like Canis, Barrow, areas that have grass growing up over them. And that way we could also have them maintain some of these medians, too, that are in really bad shape. But I've had people calling me about Canis Road all the time, and we finally did get that picked up. But these people are wanting to see this stuff done on a regular scheduled basis, so that they're not always having to call in and feeling like if this was another part of town, it wouldn't happen like this. So I'd appreciate it if you could let me know something.
Director Adcock, you're recognized,
yes.
Please.
Mr. Moore, a few months ago, my neighbor had some trees cut. And it happened to be by a man that is well known to Sue Hosley, because she gets so many complaints on him. In some neighborhoods, they've sent out newsletters telling people don't use them because they get their money, then they leave, particularly with old people. and he had it cut, and Roosevelt and his staff came out three times telling this man, don't stack them out there. Don't stack them. The man kept saying, oh, I'm going to take them. I'm going to pick them up. I'm not going to leave them. And he kept stacking more and more. He contracted with the people to cut five trees, and they went back to St. Louis. And instead of cutting a huge tree, he cut a little pecan tree. So he decided which five trees he was going to cut. But it was a huge amount. And they made three trips out there to tell that man that. They told me that they have no way of enforcing that. So first of all, you need to check to see who can enforce that, that the people cutting trees are going to have to pay for them. That man finally left, and he left all of his trees right there. And then although we had his business card and everything, I was told that they have no one to track him down. So we keep picking up. So that's why you're having to buy more boom trucks and everything, because as the mayor said, the price is a lot cheaper if they leave it on the curb. And secondly, like Director, whoever it was that said you told them last year, Director Weirich, last year when we were talking about in the mediums, which is in Gower Springs and on Mapleville Pike and 65th Street, all of those mediums have got weeds growing up now. Last year, you said you was putting something in place, and last year it was fine. This year, they're all growing up again. So we need someone to go around and look at the mediums and the curbs around the streets because they're in bad shape. People stop at the intersections and throw out their cigarette butts, and they just remain there, particularly on 65th and University. Thank you.
Okay, that Mr. Moore, did you have anything?
I hate to keep going, but the mayor and I talked with our consultants, and we have the smart mobility report that is going to be on May the 17th. As part of our contract with Nelson Nygaard, they are required to do a workshop with the city board. What we want to propose is to do that on May the 23rd.
Which is a Monday.
It's a Monday. We have five Tuesdays this month, so we weren't going to meet on the 24th. But the reason we need to meet on the 23rd is one of the principals will have to be flying out on the 24th. So we were going to propose that we have a workshop with the board on that Monday, the 23rd. It's starting around 4:00, and that's an interactive workshop. They're going to do your presentation, but they really want to hear from the board in this forum. And in the past, the workshop has been between the board and the consultant, and that's how we were going to set it up. We know there will probably be a lot of interest, so we're going to try to find a venue that people could attend. But again, the workshop would be with the Nelson Nygaard staff and the board. So I just wanted to find out, and we'll talk to Gene and Brad, but does that Monday, because we need to start planning, and does that Monday pose any major issues?
23rd?
Yes, ma'am.
I have a neighborhood meeting that I've scheduled, and my information about it has already gone out. Monday at 6.
Well, we're going to start this at 4.
Yeah, you'll hit the most of it, if not all of it. It's important for them to get feedback from us, and I think they're going to be, you know, they were at the meeting and listened and have the information that was presented by Garver Engineers and the Highway Department, and they're looking at that with a critical eye, as they said, and going to be coming back with us for more specifics. So it is important that we have this process moving forward to hear what they say about what's been proposed. Does that work for everybody? Okay, good. So,
4:00.
Yes, 4:00. That's a Monday, right? Okay. Is there anything else to come before the board? Hearing none, is there a motion to adjourn? All in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Or an adjournment. Thank you.